So what we've been working on and putting together is a system to fight the system. And I'm gonna, with no further ado, I'd like to introduce David Butterfield, who with the consent of the elders and over 200 chiefs in British Columbia, with a federally acknowledged tribe within the territorial confines of the United States, has been appointed as a federal trial division judge, and he will be rubber stamping everything that comes through from now on. So with no further ado, the Honorable Justice I.C. Butterfield.
Here comes the judge. All right, I'm not going to be speaking into this microphone for the whole process here because it's just too much. I don't have enough hands. So can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. Many of you, I guess, were here earlier today for the benefit of those who weren't. And to further that introduction, in fact, good introduction given by Pat there, I've been involved in all of this fight for freedom, really, for over 40 years. I've been challenging one level of government or another. I've been very successful. I used their stuff against them wherever I possibly could, and that's what I found worked the best. Over the years, I ended up having been involved in that stuff from an early age. Once I got into where I had a sign manufacturing company, and they were, Brian Mulroney was talking about imposing this GST, I became very, very affected, I guess, by everything that was going on. I'd already just experienced the American Free Act of Treason Agreement, Free Trade Agreement, excuse me, and watched how that destroyed the economy here. Now he was going to impose this GST, and I'd already stopped paying income taxes in 1988. And that was because I came to discover that we were still subject to the Income War Tax Act. And so I wasn't about to just, you know, go quietly into the night on this GST thing, because all of a sudden now I'm going to have a whole bunch more work to do. They're not going to pay me a penny for doing it. And if I didn't, I was going to be in a lot of trouble. And that sounded a whole lot to me like they were trying to make me a slave, because that is the definition of slavery: being caused to perform a service without pay and under the threat of punishment. And that's where every GST vendor is today. They're in slavery, full-blown slavery, as if we weren't already. Because in every province, I have found that there's, in effect, over 160 different forms of taxation. And according to forensic economists, this will remove from the average individual between 73% and 75% of their annual income. And I mean, it's no wonder everybody's having such a difficult time, because, you know, it's pretty obvious these governments aren't there to serve us. We're here to serve them. You know, you're working your butts off and giving most of your energy to them. So when Brian Mulroney finally announced his resignation, another way, there I am sitting at the front desk in my Vancouver sign shop, toasting Mum's Cordon Rouge champagne to his resignation. And I just gotta find my little pointer here. Of course, that goes real good with fillet of fish and McDonald's fries. You know? But this is where I started to discover as well that these newspaper journalists that they call themselves are actually just novelists, like this Pamela Fagan. They're hired to write stories for people. And they do quote, like, one line: "This is a great day for Canada, the man was a tyrant." Right? And then she starts writing a story about how the GST destroyed my business. That's a total lie. I mean, I refused to charge it or collect that tax because I was not going to be their slave. And in spite of the, you know, a couple of goons, you know, 6'12", you know, knuckles dragging, one eyebrow, coming in my sign shop trying to intimidate me into completing these remittance forms and collecting this tax, I threw a few legal questions at them. Judging by the looks on their faces, a number of muscles were being pulled up here. You know, so they just said, well, we'll have to ask our supervisor about that. And I said, well, that's a really good idea. You go do that. I got to get back to work. See you later. So I got a call from the excise branch manager. He's coming to my sign shop on this day and this time. And I just arranged to have the television cameras there waiting for him. I already had the front window of my sign company, half of it turned into a big bulletin board, which was easy to do, being the sign company, you know, and I had a big no symbol GST ever exclamation mark. So all of this was out there, and of course I had a nice little awning and a bus stop right in front. So in the rainy city of Vancouver, there's always someone under my awning, and there was always somebody reading my window. People ended up coming in and asking me all kinds of questions, and I started doing my little seminars right there in the front room of my sign shop. So it wasn't, I refused to charge it, and actually I got more business because of that. And it's everybody's lawful right to enter unlimited contract and not to have your trade or occupation or your pursuit of it molested in any way. You'll see all that in these documents. In fact, court ruling from their appeals court. So it was because of a car accident injury, and I got shafted by the government insurance out there. It took me 5 years to finally settle that claim. But because of that, I had to close that sign company down. So, I've been just so swallowed here by everything. And I never got to reorganize all of this from this afternoon. This is from another newspaper, the Chilliwack Times, just to show you how they never get anything right. Here they're calling me Paul Butterfield. Okay, and they say that I refused to charge the tax because it amounted to slave labor and it was illegal. And when I say illegal, I mean it did not comply with their own documents. Because their own documents, one of them is this so-called Constitution Act, which is actually the Constitution Act 1867 is actually the British North America Act. And laid out the rules for the setting up and operation of the governments and their legal industry. And under that, the powers of the Parliament and the powers of the provinces, only provinces were allowed to collect what are called direct taxes. And direct taxes include income, sales, and inheritance tax. So I'd seen a guy actually on Check 6 News, his name was Bruce Ryder, and he was setting on fire the GST registration form and burnt it right there, okay? Declared the tax completely unlawful, right? As it was a direct tax. And it was because I contacted him that and went to Nanaimo where he was situated. He showed me some documents. I came back to Vancouver, and because I'm such an analytical person, and I mean, it's not that I don't trust anybody, it's just that I don't trust anybody. So when I saw his paper, I believed checking it out for myself. You know, and I recommend that to everybody. You know, that's why I'm showing all this stuff up here. I'm not just going to stand here and blow a bunch of words past you. I'm going to show you all the factual evidence. So, anyways, here's the story about me. I'm holding up that so-called Constitution Act. Then later on, the Kelowna Capital News ran a story, and this was the, the pros and cons of the income tax, kind of.
China.
That was when I was over in China doing the presentation. Here we go. Okay, and here I'm presenting all the facts. There's only two fields of taxation, direct and indirect. The indirect taxes include tariffs, customs, and duties. Direct taxes include income, sales, and inheritance tax. The feds claim they have exclusive legislative authority or lawmaking authority over both direct and indirect taxation. And that was given to them by this so-called British North America Act. So I'm quoting from all of these different documents, and much of it is in quotations all the way down. Here I am, where was it? I quote from the second reading of the British North America Bill. Now the second reading of a bill is what the passing of that bill is totally reliant on. If the bill does not pass second reading exactly as it's read, the bill's dead. It won't go any further than that. Because after the first reading, they had all opportunity to make whatever amendments were necessary or to resolve any divisions over that, any clauses or conditions in that first reading. So that second reading made it real clear of a number of things. First off, there was never, ever a federal government created, ever. And there still hasn't been. In fact, there was only a central legislature created. There was the local legislatures, and they agreed to create this central legislature and to give it some of their powers that would be relevant to them all and important to them all, like currency and coinage and postage and military, things like that. But all of the other powers, they kept them to themselves. And one of those was direct taxation. In fact, in that second reading, it was made real crystal clear that the fourth Earl of Carnarvon, Henry Howard Molyneux, presented the reading and said, the several provinces which are now free to raise a revenue as they may think fit, because they had all the power, surrender to the central parliament all powers under that head except that of direct taxation. So that the only field of taxation the provinces had kept for themselves was direct. So that power remained exclusive only to those provincial governments. Now, what I wasn't aware of at the time I was involved in all of that was the fact that in this so-called Constitution Act, the provinces identified in here are spelled, you know, in the middle of a sentence, province is spelled with a capital P. Now, when I first saw this document, I was very questioning of the way that the language was presented here, because there's many cases where there's a verb in the middle of a sentence that they've capitalized the first letter. Now, my understanding of the rules of grammar is that then that becomes, or is shown there as, a proper noun. Because you only capitalize first letters of proper nouns and sentences and, you know, paragraphs and titles, right? You don't capitalize a verb in the middle of a sentence, you know, whatever the word may have been. Anyways, the language was rather, you know, confusing and conflicted with English, proper English. I never really recognized the capital P province. I thought that was some kind of sign of, you know, recognition of their great authority or something, you know. What ended up happening, I was out of the business and brought all of these facts forward to, you know, to the government, and they didn't care. They, you know, just were kind of dusting me off. Of course, I was just getting started in this. I was totally still naive about who they were, what the real authorities were. You know, I just thought that they were making a huge, big, illegal mistake here. So a couple of years later, I got a recall from the Revenue Canada, and they wanted me to, you know, comply with the requirement to file for 1989, 1991, and 92. I'd already figured how I was going to do that. I completed all the returns with NA, not applicable. And the reason their questions are not applicable is because who it was that was asking them. They didn't have the authority to ask me questions about direct taxation. Only provinces could do that. So I end up, I filed all these returns, and you know what ended up? They paid me a refund for an overpayment from 1988. So they completely accepted this NA filing. Mind you, it was accompanied by a 4-page cover letter and 250 pages of evidential documents, you know, substantiating my right and ability to complete that T1 return with NA, right? And when I did that, someone else found out about me doing this, and the next thing I know, I get a call from somebody up in northern BC, and they had a problem with I think it was a $58,000 reassessment from a few years prior. So, you know, I said, well, let's do this. So if you want to, we'll do it. So we did their whole filing, you know, 250 pages, all that stuff. He never heard from Revenue Canada again. They completely left him alone, went right out of his life. And they had been, like, actively assaulting him every couple of weeks for demands, you know. This was just ongoing. So they completely backed off. Now, he said to me, you know, you got to get this information out there. You got to create some kind of an organization or something so that people can learn this truth, right? And I was still in all this pain from the injuries from the car accident. Got turned on by him and his wife to some natural remedies, which I took. And what do you know, a couple of 3 days later, all this muscle spasm was gone and the pain, and I was able to sleep at night. I felt restored. I did a little presentation somewhere. Someone made a video of it. And the next thing you know, I'm getting a phone call from someone in Manitoba. And then I get a phone call from someone in some other province. I go, what is going on here? Well, I had created this little organization called Shareholders of Canada Educational Initiative, and was forwarding this kind of information to people. Within 7 months, it spread itself by word of mouth through every province right to the Atlantic Ocean. And I find myself, I'm out there in every whistle stop across the country doing presentations on this stuff and showing people all the evidence. Well, over the years, from 1994 when I created that, up to 1999, we had filed and actually served by process server in excess of 1,700 T1 returns on directly served on the Minister of National Revenue. All of these people all got notices of assessment as a result of it. Many of them got refunds, right? But what we did notice was that they took the NA and converted it and gave it a numeric value. Now, I don't know how you do that, okay? Where you've got not applicable, and they end up putting zero in there. Okay, well, if you take the word not and apply it mathematically, it's actually less than zero. It's a negative. Okay, so none of it jived or added up. We figured they're just taking this way out because they're hoping we're just going to kind of go away, right? Well, they finally, when they saw we weren't going to go away, they decided, well, let's take out the chief and all the Braves will run back to the camp, right? So they came after me, took an action and charged me with failing to comply with a requirement. Now that requirement was for me, I didn't learn this till later, but me as the trustee, I had a requirement to file a T1 return for this taxpayer, the guy whose name is spelled entirely in uppercase lettering, all capital letters. That's their own creation, their own corporate trust. I know what my name is, or at least what people have told me my name is, and next to my life, that is my most personal property. And I decide how my name is presented. It is not spelled entirely with capital letters. And as soon as you do that, you've taken away any ability to distinguish that as a name, because it's no longer a proper noun. If it was, it would only be a first letter capitalized, right? So anyways, all of this this ended up in court, and 2 years later, you know, in spite of all the documents I filed, the court was just disregarding it, dismissed this motion or that motion, and they convicted me. So I had been trying to get the whole matter into the Supreme Court the whole time, because I am aware that that court is a court of inherent common law jurisdiction. And while the provincial court where this prosecution took place, their jurisdiction is admiralty law, military, which is pretty much the same as admiralty, the civil law so far as small claims and family matters. No jurisdiction over common law whatsoever. So I was trying to get it into Supreme Court. After the conviction, I filed an appeal, and I did it under what's called an application for trial de novo. That means a new trial, because the whole first one was fraudulent, right? And that the judge had demonstrated right from the beginning that he was biased and prejudiced against me. And I was able to show all of that in the transcripts. And in fact, by the end of that 2-year trial, I stood there on the floor in front of that judge and I said to him, you know, you have allowed your personal feelings about me to influence you and interfere with your ability to render a proper judgment here. The fact is, you've shown very clearly you just don't like me. Okay? Why didn't you like me? So that was too full of some truth that I had the guts to just shove in his face. I wasn't going to back down from him, in spite of all his threats of, you know, you're on the verge of being in contempt, you know. And I mean, at times I had that guy turn purple. And if he had hair, he would have been ripping it out. He was fumbling with everything on his desk and moving it around. And, you know, and I would just stand there and say, oh, well, I had no intention of being contemptuous to anyone about anything, you know. And I carried on all this sweetness all the way through that drove him crazy, right? So, because at the same time, of course, I'm assaulting him. But I'm doing it, you know, I kind of became a master at subtle bluntness, you know. So, I filed the application for trial de novo and won. Okay, the whole conviction and everything, mind you, that whole 2 years of my life as well, was flushed right down the toilet. Unfortunately, that Supreme Court decided to exercise its discretion which is found under this criminal code of the Northwest Yukon and Nunavut Territories. Oh, pardon me. Yeah, criminal code of Canada, for those of you who aren't aware. And he exercised his discretion and sent the matter back to the provincial court to start it all over again. Well, during this whole period, of course, I have continued, as I've always done, to do further research and learn better ways of interpreting their statutes. And through a woman who was involved operating the Kelowna chapter of Shareholders of Canada, she had identified that in the Canada Pension Plan Act, she found that that only applied to people who held office in the government. And she sent her Canada, you know, her social insurance card and that back to the Minister of Human Resources, along with a letter demanding all of her money back, that she was involved in this program improperly and wasn't aware that it only applied to these guys. So anyway, she sent that letter out on email to everybody. And a guy out there who was formerly one of my kind of students under Shareholders of Canada, he took that and went and looked at the Income Tax Act, which is a kind of co-related, cooperative taxation statute, right? And he found it was exactly the same thing there. It only applied to people who held office in the government, right? And that in that act, an employee is actually just an officer. And an officer is identified in there as someone holding one of these government offices. So he started an organization, and it was called Paradigm Education Group. And he started deciding that he was had authority to certify people as human rights defenders, and he was going to take this approach of human rights. Well, I was already teaching people human rights right back into 1994. You know, that was all part and parcel when I was teaching people about what this said. I was more concerned about international human rights laws, like the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, for one, and I was bringing people's to the knowledge about those statutes or those international instruments, and helping them to learn how to exercise them. Because after all, the only rights you've got are those that you know and exercise. So he created this group, and I initially became involved with him until I discovered that he was reliant on this Canadian Bill of Rights for what, you know, he says is what got him through an income tax trial and got it all dismissed and everything, okay? But when I went further and deeper than he had decided to do in my interpretation of these various statutes, I discovered that these geographic areas that are known as provinces are in fact not part of Canada, okay? And I was very concerned about that, and I you know, was not going to accept my initial findings. I ended up, I sent a request to Justice Canada. I'm just going to fumble around here because I kind of got myself a little bit bogged up here from the earlier presentation. I sent this email request and asking them to assist me in locating a statutory instrument that provided a legal definition of Canada that was including any one of the provinces. Because the definitions that I found, like in the Federal Interpretation Act, get this out here, showed that Canada, or the province rather, was only the Northwest Territories, Yukon Territory, and Nunavut. So I looked in the Provincial Interpretation Act, and there again, it says, when used as meaning a part of Canada, includes the Northwest Territories, Yukon Territory, and Nunavut. Just let me find this, so that was very distressing. I looked in the Canada Land Survey Act and the definition of Canada lands. And there again, it only spoke of the Northwest Territories, Yukon Territory, Nunavut, national parks as defined in the National Parks Act, surrendered lands and reserves as defined in the Indian Act. Right? And this was very confusing. Nothing, no speak of British Columbia, Alberta, Saskatchewan. None of these geographic areas we call provinces. Well, what ended up happening? Here it is. Here's my request to them, okay? And I asked them, you know, I'm having the most difficult time locating a statutory instrument provides a definition of Canada that would be included in any one of the provinces. And I talked about the Canada Land Survey Act, what they define, and the Federal Interpretation Act. I'll just tell you, the Federal Interpretation Act is like a federal dictionary for all their federal law. Okay? The definitions given in there apply to all federal statutes. The only time that such that definition would not apply is if in a particular statute, like this, it gave a different definition. Then, of course, this is the definition that would apply there. Well, he completely agreed with me. Yeah, you're right. I'm quite surprised. And he ended up forwarding on this email request and to this other guy in Department of Foreign Affairs and International Trade. That's what that is, stands for. And he said, the question in the email below is, there's some instrument that defines Canada's boundaries is rather interesting, given that I can't find an answer to it. Yet one would think it should be simple to answer. I'm hoping that you or someone in the Department of Foreign Affairs are able to enlighten both the original questioner and myself. Well, I can tell you that email exchange went on for a number of days, so probably a couple of weeks. And it ended up, that question was circulated throughout every law department of Justice Canada. They also referred me to the Parliamentary Library, where I dealt with this woman, Genevieve Giroux. Okay, right here. And she referred me to, well, those are two, but some other websites as well. I checked out those websites and I said to her, thank you. However, the site appears to provide information relating more to the boundaries of the various provinces. And most references are pre-1931, before the historical statute of Westminster provided the transfer of the sovereign power from the monarchy to the people of the former colonies. Now that's something that happened and came into force December 11th, 1931. But unfortunately, nobody was told about it. Why would that be? Well, as soon as you've got all of the people now being set free from the monarchy, because when he transferred his sovereign power, he became the last British monarch to have lawful authority over another human being. And we became the sovereign power, you and me, okay? All of us. We became the highest authority. We became independent of the monarchy, and so did the colonies. And in fact, it says right in the statute, the term colony can never again be used. Okay? So now we don't have any colonies anymore. We've got 10 independent nations. Well, the central legislature that calls itself the federal government didn't like that at all, because that meant they were out of a job. Because as soon as you got 10 independent nations that are no longer colonies, how could they legally continue legally to participate in a colonial union? Well, they couldn't. And in fact, not only did the Statute of Westminster give them their independence and make them all sovereign independent nations, but it made redundant both the office of the Governor General, because that office was created only to have a liaison, someone to act as medium between the monarchy and the government of Canada. As soon as the monarchy removes himself from the equation, why would you need someone to act in between them? It's not necessary anymore. It also made the central legislature redundant and no longer necessary, because we've got no more need for a central legislature. All the other legislatures are separate independent countries now. Okay, well, they didn't like that, so they didn't tell us. In fact, they went out and they paid lawyers to write opinions that basically said they did not believe it was legally possible for the monarch to abdicate his sovereign power. Okay. And that was basically covering their own butts. So, as we went through this email exchange, it ends up that they referred me to this Professor Ted McDorman. I'm going to get back to that Statute of Westminster in a minute. He is an expert in the geographic boundaries of all the provinces, professor at the University of British Columbia. And I spoke with him for about 40 minutes. Right here, I've inserted that I had a lengthy conversation with him and that I was not able to provide any direction or answer to the original question. I wrote back to Ed Hicks, told him that, because he's shown interest himself in finding an answer to this, I offered some of this other information about the Scotch to Westminster, etc. What ended up happening after it went through Oceans Environmental Law and, well, through the Department of Foreign Affairs, International Trade, and one other law department there, I'm trying to remember what it was now, he came back and he said, where is it? Right here. You know, he did try to assist in finding a form of legislative instrument that defines the physical boundaries of Canada. There does not appear to be such a thing. Okay. Now, you've got to understand something as you're going to get through this, that as a result of all of this information and research that I did here, and now having confirmation in writing that the provinces are not part of Canada, and when I look at the Federal Interpretation Act and see the definition given for small p province, that is, means a province of Canada and includes the Northwest Territory, Yukon Territory, Nunavut. And then I see the provincial one that says, when used as meaning a part of Canada, includes the Northwest Territories, Yukon Territory, and Nunavut. Well, I had a look at that word includes, and now somebody else, that guy who created Paradigm, he claims he did about a month of investigation on the word. Well, I didn't have to do that long. I just went and I found three court rulings, Supreme Court of Canada rulings on the word includes, that all confirmed the word is restrictive. Now, I also noticed that every statutory instrument I'd looked at in the interpretation section, which is like the definition section, this is where you're supposed to be able to go to gain better ability to interpret those statutes properly. They were using this word includes alternately with the word means. They'd say, this means this, and then this includes this, right? And like in the Income Tax Act, which I'll show you here later, in this act, that's how every interpretation section starts, it says in this act, employee includes officer. Now most people might look at that, and because includes just happens to be one of the most commonly misused and confused words of the English language, you know, and when I discovered that in their own publication from the Translation Bureau, Department of Public Works, Government Canada, it's identified as one of the most commonly misused and confused words, I'm going like, well, why would they do that? Why would they put that most confused word in a definition? Use it to provide a definition in these sections called the interpretation sections. It seems to defeat the whole purpose of having an interpretation section. Unless, of course, it was their key to their design to deceive everybody. Now the word includes, I looked at, I found those three rulings, but I also found like Merriam-Webster's Dictionary of English Usage. And I'm gonna go right into that here, just to show you. Here's the part from Canadian Style. The chapter entitled, Words Commonly Misused and Confused. Few pages, you know, alphabetically listed words in there, there's the word include. And I see, well, they've got it showing that include and comprise are confused with each other. And they're saying that when you use the word includes, it only implies a part of the whole. And that comprise implies all. And that seemed to conflict with all the language authorities, the recognized language authorities like Merriam-Webster's and Gage's and other dictionaries that are out there. Now here's where we go to Merriam-Webster's, their Dictionary of English Usage, right here. Hope you all can read that, and the word include. And they talk about people, certain commentators, who insist that when you use the word include, you should not provide a complete list of the things that are supposed to be included. There's only a part of the whole, in other words, a part of the list. She goes on to, or it goes on rather here to confirm that, where is it here? They give examples. They say the prison includes, and they show everything that's included in the prison. His clubs include the Althenian, the Carlton, the Palmer's, the Beefsteak, the Brilliants. Then they say there is nothing wrong with either of these examples. They fit the requirements of Fowler, 1926 to 65. Now Fowler is a grammarian, an expert in the usage of words of the English language. Down here, they say the critics above, however, have somehow reasoned themselves into the notion that with include, all of the components must not be mentioned, which has never been the case. So what we've learned here is that with the word includes, all of the components that are to be seen as being included have to be listed there after the word. They have to be. So if you see a sign that says dinner includes dessert, you better not be hungry, because all you're going to get is dessert. Mind you, if the sign said dinner is including dessert, different story. And that's what causes the confusion, because you simply add ing to that particular word, and now it's all changed. Now it is only part of the whole. So I hope you're following on this, because that is the key to their design to deceive us. In fact, it's worked so well, they've got their lawyers and accountants and everyone else out there operating on that misuse and confusion of the word. Now, I wasn't quite satisfied with that. I went to the Supreme Court House downtown Vancouver, and with the purpose of, like I said, looking for those Supreme Court rulings, and I saw this dictionary sitting there, and I said, you know, what's this? And she said, well, that's the judge's dictionary. It's like this big, you know, sitting up on the counter. So that's where all the judges look up words of English that they want to get clarification of the meanings. So I looked up the word includes in here. And here it is right here. To shut in, enclose, confine, embrace. You see that word? Comprise. In other words, comprise is actually a synonym of includes. It means exactly the same thing, which further confirms that includes is the total. If you said water comprises oxygen and hydrogen, then that's all there is, right? So you could very well also say water includes hydrogen and oxygen. And that's the complete list that's included in water. And then it goes on to say it's confining or containing in within limits of space. So in other words, the word is restrictive. What is shown here is all that there is. Now we also, to confirm further on that word, just I can't emphasize this enough to you. I want to make sure that it's perfectly clear for you all. There is what are called maxims, which is also known as an axiom. Okay? And it's a short rule of conduct, or a proverb, a statement of general truth. Look before you leap. Or as another example, if you step off that cliff, you will fall to the bottom. So it's like a set of facts that need no proof. Like it says down here, a self-evident truth. Okay? A statement seen to be true without proof. If I add 2 plus 2, doesn't matter how I do it, if I'm standing on my head, upside down or backwards, I'm always going to get 4. That's a mathematical axiom. Okay? It doesn't matter which way you do that equation, you'll always end up with the same answer. So, the following is a maxim in law. This is called a legal maxim. This is a universally recognized rule of law. And it's a set of facts that need no proof. And it is written in Latin, of course, inclusio unius est exclusio alterius. And expressed in English, the inclusion of one is the exclusion of another. So if all I've included is one thing, then everything else has been expressly excluded. So if I was to say that water includes hydrogen, I've excluded oxygen. So you know that statement's false. If I said water is including oxygen, you know I've use the word including, which means it's only part of the list that I'm showing there, or part of the whole, so now that statement is true. So that's where the confusion comes in. Take the ing away, it's confining, restricting, what's listed there is all that there is. Put the ing on it, what's listed there may well be only part of the whole list. So that's really the key to properly interpreting these statutes. Now, again, I've gone on with, I'm just showing you these ones, but I've checked it in numerous other dictionaries out there, and it's all the same thing as it was there, you know, in this judge's dictionary, to comprise or confine, shut in, and close. So, Now, what I also discovered through this little publication, and again, this is from the Translation Bureau. Inside here, you can find that they are, and this is available in most bookstores, like Chapters and that.
Oh, my little
list of points, all the important things I discovered in here, reading the whole thing. In here it says that, in the preface, the Translation Bureau, a special operating agency of the Department of Public Works and Government Services Canada, is pleased to present the second edition of the Canadian Government's English-Language Editorial Style Guide, the Canadian Style. Now it says Canadian Government's English-Language. And it's apostrophe S, governments, which is possessive. So it's their English-Language. Now, I'm seeing it, and then I look further in here and I see, oh, you know what it says here? Corporations and institutions use their own internal languages designed for internal readership. But the best part was, when I looked in here again, this is at this page titled, oh, that's the next one, sorry. Under geographical areas, what I just had it here. There it is. Geographical areas, or geographic terms rather. And right here, do not capitalize a generic term such as city, county, state, or province when it precedes the proper noun or stands alone. So, city of Toronto, it's a small c if I'm referring to the geographic area. Okay? Small c, Toronto, or city rather, because you don't capitalize it. And the only time you capitalize it is when it's used in a corporate sense. In other words, if you're referring to a corporate entity or a corporation. And there's the examples. She lives in the geographic area of Regina, small c. I've traveled all over the geographic area of Ontario. But down here, by Corporation of Ontario Bonds, the Corporation of Regina took him to court. Now, you start to realize that, holy smokes, you know, when I think about it, everything that that government is about is generating revenue for itself. It is like selling its own, selling these laws that we all paid them to write for us. And they sell them to us for profit for themselves. What's this about? Well, it's right there. And then I discover, of course, like I said earlier, the powers that were given by this thing were only given to the capital P provinces. Then I start looking at government documents and I discover that I can't find a government document anywhere that identifies a government for, or even of, the small p province of British Columbia. There's only a government of the capital P province of British Columbia. What does that mean? Well, that means Board of Directors of the Corporation of British Columbia. And then I start discovering that it's the same thing with the municipalities and the cities. Okay, the capital C city. I look at bylaws and other instruments to say that this bylaw applies within the capital C city of Surrey, or the capital C city of Toronto, or whatever it be. So what does that mean? Well, it only applies within the corporation. Now, you look at this in conjunction with some of the evidence that was exposed in Aaron Russo's Freedom to Fascism movie that he produced, where they bring out those U.S. Supreme Court rulings on the income tax down there that show that there's no income tax act that applies to individuals, that only applies to corporations. Now I'm looking at the income tax up here and I see, hey, guess what? It looks to me like this only applies to corporations as well. In fact, it only applies, like Moira Drostovich, the woman I told you about who wrote the letter to Canada Pension, or about Canada Pension, it only applies to people who hold office in that government. And all of these governments, including Canada, it's all now been confirmed beyond any reasonable doubt, they're 100% pure corporations. And in fact, Canada and all of these capital P provinces are direct subsidiary corporations of, hope you're ready for this, the United States of America Corporation. And how do we know this? Well, here they are, registered on the Securities and Exchange Commission of the United States of America as a company, Canada, and shown head office, Washington, D.C. Okay? I've currently got a request into the Securities and Exchange Commission for documents identifying ownership of these corporations. Because these are the guys we're ultimately going to be going after, is the individual principals, okay, rather than serving claims and judgments on their agents, like attorney generals and such. So, we've confirmed it. These governments are pure corporations. Now, if they're corporations, then they can't do contract or enter contract directly with any human being. Because a corporation is no different than this. It's just a piece of paper. And the only way a corporation can fulfill its purpose or have any function at all is through the voluntary involvement of a man or a woman. And the man or woman will sign something on behalf of the corporation, like a contract. And then some other human being will sign the contract on behalf of another corporation, right? But to contract directly with me as a man, they can't legally do that. So what did they do? Well, they created a thing called a requirement for a statement of birth when your children are born, and then they actually threaten the parents if they don't provide this information, you're going to be subject to a fine. So it's like through threat of punishment, they extort this information about the child. We want his name and everything else, right? And what do? They then steal that identity and they alter it. They represent it entirely in uppercase lettering and produce a birth certificate for that entity, not for your child. Okay? And the key word was registration. You have to register the birth. And anything that you register with these corporate structures of government, you've unknowingly agreed to share ownership of it with them. And if you look at anything that you have registered, look at the name it's been registered in. Look at your automobile, look at the insurance, look at your land titles, the office, the names there. All of them are that all capital letter entity. That is in fact a corporate trust. And you are all the trustees of that trust. Now, just as a little piece of evidence here as to that being a fact and how the corporation government and their agents have accepted that, because of all my years of filing NA returns, and by the way, when it was sent back to provincial court, that court case, I just went in and I was in the middle of dealing with mercury poisoning at the time, and I entered a plea of being too sick to stand trial for anything. I said, I'm guilty of being too sick to stand trial. So, really, I didn't care what was happening anymore because I had discovered all of this stuff. And I wasn't going to waste my time in their court of commerce, which is now I have written confirmation after a six-month written exchange with the chief judge of the provincial court system in British Columbia. He finally, in the end, his last communication with me, admitted his court's a corporation. And what else could it be? It was created by a corporation. You know? So, hey folks, we've all been sucked in big time, you know. Don't get mad at me about it, please. You know, I'm just the messenger. These are the factual truths. You're going to see a whole bunch more evidence, but here's how I now file T1 returns, because I've had all these years of filing with NA. Now I file them with zeros, okay? And they sent me a letter saying, based on your past year's filings, plurals, okay, we're sending you the simple T1SC return, David, which is a credit and benefit return. Okay, can I just ask you to just hang on 1 second? And here this is how I've completed the returns previous. For the all capital letter guy, now this is their typed label that they sent me. Okay, I've blocked out the address here because it's not my address anymore. But this is how I always hand wrote it in. The all caps guy, that's who needed to be filed for. That's who the taxpayer is. That's the debtor. That's the accused. That's the guilty. Okay? That's the one that was born to lose. Right? And they got you believing it's you. And I put care of trustee. Because I know it's a trust. I've been named the trustee. And that's the thing under the laws of trust, and you can check it out yourself. I can create a trust right now and name any one of you as the trustee. And I don't have to tell you. I don't have to tell you that you're the trustee of this trust, right? But they got us all acting as the trustee. I mean, everything that we do is in its name, your bank account, your telephone bill, look in your driver's licenses that the government's issued you, or for that matter, any other piece of identification that you're carrying around that you think is yours, which is not, okay? I mean, even the BC driver's license, on the back of this little corporate document, it says right here, this card remains the property of the issuing agent. So it's definitely not my driver's license. It says it right there. You know? Now you look at all the other pieces of ID you got from the government, so they're masters to banks, and that name on there is not yours. It's the all capital letter one. But that's how they're able to seize a whole bunch of your property if they want to, because it's actually not yours. It's theirs already. They've just got you working your ass off to pay for it and maintain it. You don't own anything. And that, by the way, is your third natural right given you by the Creator. Life, liberty, property. And that's confirmed in a court of appeal ruling I'm going to show you here back from 1909 when there was some respect for humans and their rights. Okay? So this is how I now complete it. And as you can see, it's a very simple return. In fact, it's quick, one page.
Quick question. Would you put square brackets around the postal code? Because remember, that's
no
jurisdiction as well.
No, because that is a commercial entity.
Oh, okay.
I can leave that commercial. No, when I'm addressing something from myself, the man, naturally created man, I write non-commercial, and I don't put a postal code. I don't use it. Because that is part of their, basically their commercial identification system. Yes,
question. Have you ever been reassessed on these returns?
No.
Why?
And by the way, the only reason that I even do this file at all is because this is a method by which I can recover some of the money that's stolen from me every day of the week. Because as a result of this, I'm going to show you right here, this is how I complete them. Well, that's the British Columbia tax credit, pardon me, but that doesn't matter. I'm claiming $75 provincial sales tax rebate there. And I hope I can find it here fairly quickly. The last page of the return is about 6 lines, not much more than that, and they're all completed with zeros as well. And what did I do with that? Oh my God. I wish I had had time to come in here and organize this, but I got swallowed after doing a presentation here this afternoon and never got a chance. So swallowed by everybody else with questions and stuff. Anyways, what I do is I've completed all zeros, and that way I get full GST rebate. I get quarterly payments from them for that, and I get this PST rebate.
David,
if
you're doing this for the first time, would you recommend that we put down NA or just put in zeros?
If you're doing this for the first time and you're employed by Walmart or somebody like that?
Well, I'm just remembering, I haven't done my income tax yet from this past year.
You haven't done whose income tax?
My corporations.
See, this is mindset, folks, and I wish I had a machine at that door that would have reformatted your hard drives for you as you walked in, because you're going to continue to think that way. My taxes, you've got to pay your taxes, and I haven't done my income tax yet. Now, it's not yours. It's got nothing to do with you. Nothing. You're the trustee. You can't be responsible for something that's their creation, just like the national debt is their creation. It was created by their passing of the Bank Act, 1913.
So if I go home tonight and I just kind of figure, I don't have to calculate anything, I'll just put in zero.
Well, first off, let me look at what your personal situation is.
I would suggest you do that. David, I'm going to interrupt because Eldon, he's got something
doesn't
a little
work.
Different than your material.
I know, it doesn't work.
So I've been looking at that too, and some people in Toronto here have been filing that way. There's actually some people here in this meeting that have done that way. And I just wanted to send the alert that there's a differences, and we need to study what we're doing.
I had some people up in BC do that, okay? And they finally, because of the continued pressure that came on them from doing that, they finally just collapsed and said, we're just going to pay it, you know, because they were, actually they're on pension, and they were having their pensions garnished, okay, leaving them nothing. So they used Eldon's process, and it didn't work for them, you know, and it was much more complicated. But anyways, the point that I was going to get across to you is it completely depends on your personal situation. I mean, if you're working, you know, for some big corporation, you know, that's withholding income taxes from you and that, you can't really do this.
Self-employed.
You're in a perfect position then. You're in control, or more greater control of your own life. So yeah, you can do this way.
If you do that, you can't claim all those wonderful expenses and stuff to reduce your...
Well, of course you don't, because you're only putting zeros on all the lines.
You can't do that.
Okay?
No, that's fine. I don't need to.
You don't claim deductions if you've got no income. Let me just... I hope I can find it here, because I wanted to show you how I complete the last page.
You get a P4, right? A slip? If you're working as an employee? Is that in a particular context?
I'm just going to tell you how I, at the end of the return, I sign it where it says it completely, or all the documents are true and correct, all the documents and statements are true and correct. I write in there, to the best of my knowledge, okay? Because I have no idea what other sources of income or what income might be generated for this corporate trust through other things they're doing with it, okay? And then I autograph it. And I put per David E. Butterfield, all capital letters. And underneath that, I write without understanding. Because I have no way of knowing how it is that I'm suddenly required to do this for something that they created. You know, how they're able to suck me into doing this. So
David, I think it's better to differentiate the entities with the long signature. People here in Ontario, we're doing it that way. You know, by two colons with the all caps name, with the autograph, copyright, comma, authorized representative.
Yeah, but I'm not copywriting, okay? I mean, some people want to do that and go through all that process, fine, but guess what? I'm a man.
Yeah, but you've got to distinguish.
And I don't need to copyright any name that I believe is mine, or at least hearsay says is mine. I'm a man, okay? And in fact, that name, like I said, it's just hearsay. I don't have any way of proving it. I talked about this earlier.
I don't even know if my parents are actually my parents. You could sign
what?
You could add comma trustee.
Comma trustee?
Yeah, you could put in comma and then trustee.
Hey, I don't know. It's not broken, so I'm not going to fix it, all right? Okay, all right? It's been working fine for me since 1988.
Okay.
And you know, you're trying to tell me I should change the way
no,
I do it?
No, I'm just saying there's different
No, it works for me. So I'm just staying right where I am with that. And it's not going to be for long anyhow. I don't expect that I'm going to be having to file another one of those for the corporate trust, because this game is just about over that they've been playing against us out there. Just let me carry on here, Peter, because... Here, by the way, again, from their Canadian style on capitalization, this portion or chapter on military terms. Here they are saying that in Department of National Defense documents, the specific part of an exercise name is written entirely in uppercase, example, silent defender. So perhaps those names on those ID you're carrying around is just simply the name of an exercise, a military exercise. Because that's the only place in that whole book where they allow full caps, all capital letters, okay? But in the rules of grammar of English, if it was proper English, and of course we know it's their own internal language, under the rules of grammar of English, there is no allowance, in other words, no provision, for any word of this language to be presented entirely in uppercase lettering. So we know that that's not proper English, it's their English, and it's not subject to the rules of grammar, because it's their own language. Okay. Now, just so I'm going to repeat what I've said earlier again here, that apparently a lawyer was asked if he could define law in less than 10 words. And he said, oh, simple. The masterful use of the language. And that is precisely what it is. We've seen that through their usage of the word includes, you know, where it's pretty obvious it's designed to deceive you. I mean, just using it alternately with the word means. Why would they do that if they both have this exact same, you know, effect? You know, I could say, you know, employee means officer in this act. Why would I decide to say employee includes officer? And then by doing that, having one definition use the word means, and the next one use the word includes, I get the perception that somehow these two words are different. They have a different effect. You know, so it couldn't be means. But the truth of it is, you can just take the word includes, chuck it, and stick the word means in there. Because remember, whatever is following that word includes is exactly what that word means. If employee includes officer, then employee means officer. Right? And you'll see that's exactly the words they use in here. Employee includes officer. So, I started to put together all of these instruments once I had that little exchange with Justice Canada. And I was, you know, though I still couldn't really accept it. I mean, after all, I've been running an organization called Shareholders of Canada for 8.5 years. You know, and now all of a sudden I had to go and tell everybody, guess what? We've been barking up the wrong tree. You know, they're over in that other tree laughing their heads off at us. Because we're over here going, you know, at something that's not even there. You know, so, and I have no problem admitting that, you know, we're on the wrong path there. But again, so it's all a path of discovery. Who's ever done this before?
Not yet.
Nobody, okay? Nobody. If they have, I've never heard of them. You know, but neither of anybody else I've ever met. So I needed to put together a little package that would serve not only to file a complaint with the High Commissioner for Human Rights at the United Nations, a man who I investigated thoroughly before I found, you know, felt it was worthwhile to even write to him. His name was Sergio Vieira de Mello, and he was the High Commissioner for Human Rights. At the time that I sent this, put this binder together and sent it, he was in Iraq. I didn't know that. This arrived in Geneva. He was in Iraq, and 4 days after this arrived, he was murdered. A truck drove into the UN building right underneath his office. Eyewitnesses report it didn't explode. It was hit by a missile from a helicopter. And the only helicopter in the area was a US military helicopter.
Oh.
Okay. Then CNN reports that if any man on the planet could have ended the occupation in Iraq, it was Sergio Vieira de Mello. So, I guess we know why the United States was motivated to just eliminate this guy. They did not want anybody interfering with their occupation. Now, who was going to guard their oil? Right? So, that's what that was about. And I was very disappointed when I discovered that, or heard that on CNN. And I'd already said in here, you know, like, if I don't hear back from you guys, like, in so many days, I'm going to end up being forced to spread this information out there by every means I can find. You know, and if full-blown anarchy ends up being realized here, you know, well, then that responsibility lies with you guys. You had the opportunity and the ability to do something and didn't. So I put this package together. I wrote it in very plain English so that anyone would be able to understand it. You know, when it came down to it, if I was going to have to disperse it and disseminate it around to everyone. And just let me find it here. Sorry about this. Here we go. It's right here in my hand. It's all upside down and backwards. Gee, that fits right in with their statues.
What you're saying about anarchy?
Well, that's where we are. We're in a legal condition of anarchy. I mean, you only got a government of the capital P province of Ontario. That's the board of directors of the Corporation of Ontario. You don't have a government for the geographic area and its inhabitants of Ontario, which would be a government for the small P province of Ontario. That doesn't exist.
What I found about that word, though, is that it really originates from a meaning of governing oneself.
What word?
The anarchy. Means to govern oneself.
And that's what we're all doing, because we are the sovereign. We're the highest authority.
Black's Law defines, you know, it as destroying centralized government. But
well, that's actually, when you look at the terms government de facto and government de jure, as provided both in Black's and in these other law dictionaries, then it kind of makes sense to you that what we've got here is a corporation whose statutes, all copyright protected. I mean, most of you should realize what that means. What's the whole purpose of copywriting something? You copyright to protect your private opinion or idea. So when you copyright protect a statute, it's telling you this is a private idea here. And that's why they sell it to you. Because if these were actually public laws, they'd belong to all of us. There wouldn't be any copyright. And all of us would be able to access them free of charge. Because after all, didn't we already pay these governments to write these things for us? But no, if you want to see the official version, you got to buy it from them. Right? Like example, you can get the Income Tax Act, legal text. That's how they identify it. $360.45 from the Queen's Printer in Hull, Quebec. But it's worth it because they put a nice red bow around it and everything. Yeah, so, and I mean, actually all you need to do is read the interpretation section of it, or any statute for that matter. And that's exactly what this binder allows people to do. You can, once you've read, just actually you only need to read of this whole binder, that much of it, okay? Because all the rest here is like exhibits to the affidavit. They're here only so you can confirm that what I've quoted here is accurate. Right? I've put copies of the interpretation sections of their various instruments from the Canadian style relative to the commonly misused words, the geographical areas, all of those language authorities that I just showed you, they're all in here. Excerpts from the criminal code, the definition of every one person, owner. Now, you just look at that, and they've got every one. That's two words. It doesn't say everyone. Okay? It's every one. Now, when it's two words like that, it most always refers to things. If it's one word, everyone, it most always refers to people. But then you've got, after that, person. Well, we already know that in these other statutes we've looked at, when we looked at the definition of person, you know what it says? Includes a corporation. So, what is a person? A corporation. In any law you look in, federal or provincial, when you read the word person, it's not talking about a man or a woman, it's talking about a corporation. That's also why on most government forms that you might have been caused to complete, in all their little boxes that they have, everything's in boxes, which means that every one of those little boxes is a separate document that's under the laws of boxing, just like they do on these driver's licenses. Okay? There's a picture, and it's in a nice little black box border. And then there's another box with the birth date, and then another box with an autograph. Three separate documents, not necessarily relevant to any of the others. And definitely not relevant to this information over here. Okay, that likeness is on there to show that I'm the one who's the trustee. I'm the bearer of this card for the trust. Right? And I've paid out of my pocket so the trust can have this issued to it. And I carry it around. Right? I should show you my other one. Here, I gotta show you this. This is good. This is really good. Most of you have got those red and white social insurance cards. Hey, you follow my path, you get the gold card. Yeah. I'm a preferred customer. In fact, they speed up delivery of my PST and GST rebate checks to me.
How'd you get a gold one? Because I just got one. I paid $10 for it. Didn't give me a gold one.
They didn't?
No.
Gee, I wonder why that is. Maybe that's because you want to put the colons and everything on there. I'm just kidding you. Anyways, well, I got this at the Pacific National Exhibition from an agent who was licensed by the government of Canada, the Corporation of Canada, and to sell these things to people. And I paid $10 for this one too. And in fact, I questioned him when he was making it out. I says, hey, can't you spell my name in proper English? And he said, no, we have to put them in all capital letters.
Nice try.
Right? But yeah,
what is it?
Hey?
What is it?
Social insurance card.
Oh, I see.
Slave identification number, you know?
Oh, I want a couple of those.
You know? Otherwise, like in The Wizard of Oz, the Tin Man, tin taxpayer identification number, you know? Yeah, well, that's what this is about. And I, like I said, I'm the preferred customer. Actually, I'm the guy that they love to hate the most.
Well, really, how'd you get it in gold, like gold colors?
That's the way that they're all kind of, from this particular guy. And yeah, the, like I said, that was, geez, good 10 years ago. So anyways, let me get back to myself here.
I was starting to dig out this. I mean, that's how good the promo is, right, David?
What's that?
They've got great promo, they even got you to buy one.
Yeah, exactly.
That's how good it is.
No, well, actually, it's because ICBC, the government insurance out there, had just finished hiring a bunch of kids to go around and look in people's cars and see if they left any valuables or the doors unlocked or keys in the ignition or anything like that. And if they'd done, you know, like left 15 cents sitting in the console or something like that, this kid writes out a blue ticket. So it looks like you got a ticket on your windshield. He sticks it there and said, you know, we're trying to prevent crime. You know, so we're letting you know. We identified you've left valuables visible inside your vehicle, which would, you know, motivate someone to break in your vehicle.
Right?
Oh, yeah. So that was on my windshield that day. Then the next day I went out and my vehicle had been broken into. So I'm sure like these kids are going around, they're scoping out all these vehicles and they're getting paid to do it by the government. Right? Then they tell their friends.